Everybody mute so that I don't have any disturbance when I'm presenting. Okay. So thank you once again for inviting me for these talks. And I'm happy to be part of this PG teaching courses online. And I'm going to give you a series of lectures which are related to radiotherapy planning for cervical cancer. And as introduced, I'm professor in radiation oncology, but now I have moved out of Tata Memorial Hospital and I have come to another Tata hospital, which is based at Vishakhapatnam. That's Homi Baba Cancer Hospital, Vishakhapatnam. So I have planned 4 lecture series. Each would last for 30 to 40 minutes. And the details are shown here in the slide. So today's talk will be essentially only on external beam radiation for cervical cancers, and emphasis will be on conventional treatment planning, which is more or less forgotten by most of the people who are trained these days. Before we go into the details, I would like to give you some background introduction. And the slide shows, in short, the incidence and prevalence and mortality of cervical cancer. Every year, we see 5 lakh new cervical cancers across the world, out of which 80% of the cancers come from developing countries, which includes India. And India contributes roughly around 1/5 of the incidence, that is roughly 1 lakh cases. Can everybody please mute? And out of 1 lakh new cervical cancer patients, there are roughly 80,000 who would require radiation at some point.
Everyone, please mute yourselves.
You can mute them.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Somebody is down with COVID. Huh? So please mute yourselves, please. Thank you. So out of 80,000 women who need radiation, radical radiation remains the mainstay for locally advanced cervical cancer. And of course, along with radiation therapy, you always need to give concurrent chemo, mainly cisplatin, to improve the outcome further. And every cervical cancer patients who are treated with radical radiation therapy should always receive a combination of external beam radiation and brachytherapy. If the patient has not received brachytherapy, it means you have compromised. Can you mute them? Yeah. So the next slide shows there is somebody who is still unmute. Yeah, now it's okay. So please maintain it for 15-20 minutes more. Yeah. So now this is a slide which shows in short what evaluation has to be done for a patient who has come with you to you for suspected cervical cancer. The first important investigation is diagnostic biopsy, which is in the form of punch biopsy, If the lesion is very early, then you could do a colposcopy guided biopsy. And if the lesion is endocervical, then endocervical curettage will help to establish the diagnosis. And second important is it will also give you which is the histological type. The second important part of evaluation is staging investigations. Staging investigations include clinical pelvic examination. If clinical pelvic examination is not adequate, and if you feel that the examination is suboptimal, patient should be taken up for examination under anesthesia. And most important is document the disease with the help of clinical drawings, and I will show you an example of that. The second most important staging investigation is imaging. And here I've shown an imaging example of a CT abdominal pelvis or MRI pelvis for objective evaluation of local disease and regional disease. Regional disease in the form of extension to parametrium and the lymph node metastasis. What is important is invariably a lot of people ask you which imaging modality should be done for every patient. Of course, it depends on what are the... So maybe somebody has joined new. So the imaging modality for staging depends on the institutional practice and the resources available. For example, if your institution has a CT, then you should do a CT abdominal pelvis. If your institution does not have a CT, then you should go for an ultrasound. And if you think that you can afford to get an imaging done from neighboring center, get an imaging done from neighboring center. So minimum these days, after FIGO 2018, it appears that minimum imaging required is CT abdominal pelvis. MRI pelvis scores over CT abdomen because of virtue of good characteristics seen at the primary tumor. So the extent of disease, local extent of disease is seen better on MRI pelvis than CT. The other supporting investigations are cystoscopy, proctoscopy, and biopsy if required. This depends on your clinical examination findings. When you have shown that there is an involvement of rectal mucosa or bladder mucosa clinically. The other staging investigation includes chest X-ray to rule out metastasis in the lung. The imaging done in the past and which were recommended by FIGO were intravenous pyelography and ultrasound to see the kidney status. And now, of late, a lot of people do PET-based imaging to find out the entire staging in one imaging. The third part of evaluation are the tests which are required to define and tailor your treatment. For example, CBC, renal function tests, liver function tests, coagulation profile, viral markers, and depending on the comorbidities, thyroid profile, cardiac evaluation, etc. By doing this, 99% of your evaluation is complete for a patient who has suspected cervical cancer. And once the reports are in place, the next important aspect is to stage the patient properly. And I'm not going to go into the details of staging. You are supposed to read these staging, which were revised in 2018 and implemented in 2019. And the revision which came, which are pertinent for radiation oncologists are as shown, as highlighted here. One is divided into 1A1 and 1A2, where in 1A2, the lateral extent is no longer considered. Earlier, it was defined as a stromal invasion between 3 and 5 millimeters, but the lateral extent also less than 7 millimeters, but this is removed now. And the stage 1B, which was earlier 1B1 and 1B2, now it has been classified into 1B1, 1B2 and 1B3 based on the greatest dimension. So when you examine the patient, you'll have to define the greatest dimension, either the width or the thickness, or if you are able to measure the height. So if the invasion is roughly measuring less than 2 centimeters in greatest dimension, then it is 1B1. If it is between 2 and less than 4 centimeters, it is 1B2. And if it is more than or equal to 4, then it is 1B3. And 2A remains the same as earlier. And in stage 3, there is an additional subclassification in the form of stage 3C. 3C is nothing but involvement of pelvic and or parotid lymph nodes. And this is subdivided into 3C1 and 3C2. 3C1, if the pelvic lymph node metastases are seen, and 3C2 would be paraaortic lymph node metastases. And that is why I said earlier that the staging, initially it was clinical, and now it has become clinico-radiological staging by virtue of adding an imaging modality to identify pelvic or paraaortic lymph node metastases, as well as to find out what is the status of the kidney. Stage 4 remains the same. Stage 4B would be distant metastasis. Stage 4A would be invasion of or spread to the adjacent pelvic organs. What is important to put down in your staging is to, which is highlighted in the bottom, for stage 3C, you have to add R if it is done by imaging. You have to put a P if it has been done by virtue of, let's say, biopsy or a lymph node staging by laparoscopy or open. So that would be stage 3C1R or stage 3C1P based on the pelvic lymph node positivity and the imaging or surgery done. This is a very important slide which shows in detail the clinical drawings. And these clinical drawings have been adopted from the a famous EMBRACE trial, which you need not go into details at this moment. But what it shows is that this is the clinical drawing which you should implement in your routine clinical workflow. On the left upper corner, that's the sagittal view, where you can see the uterus, the cervix, vagina divided into upper third, middle third, and lower third. Anteriorly is the bladder and urethra. Posteriorly is the rectum and the anal canal. And what you see is a scale which is in the axis of the uterus. And the second diagram is a coronal view, which shows again the uterus, cervix, and at the level of cervix, you see on both the sides laterally the parametrial tissue, which is divided into medial parametrium and lateral parametrium. And vagina again is divided into three parts, upper, middle, and lower. And the third section is the axial section, where you can see the cervix and the parametrial extent up to almost lateral pelvic wall here, and posteriorly is the rectum, anteriorly is the cervico-vesical fat plane, and then the bladder in front. In the lower bottom half is the speculum view, where you can see the cervix, external os, and these are the fornices, which are shown in dark red, dark lines, thick lines, and the remaining dotted lines denote the upper third, middle third, and beyond this, the lower third vagina. And when you want to document the vaginal disease, you should always document it in clockwise direction and the length involved. Anterior vaginal wall length, posterior vaginal wall length, right lateral wall, and left lateral wall in terms of centimeters. And in the circumference, the clock positions from where it is extending into. What you see in the center are the dimensions which you are supposed to document. And these dimensions will help you to define the exact stage. Height, which is in the axis of the cervix and uterus. Width is the width of the disease at the cervix going into the both the parametriums. And thickness is anteroposterior extent of the disease. So once you document height, thickness, and width, what we have also done is we need to, there is a additional dimension which we have started documenting now, that is in relation to where the cervix would be, the canal would be on both the sides. Either side, we measure what is the width from the central canal on the right side, from the central canal on the left side, and that we document them separately. So the width is subdivided into right near maximum distance and left near maximum distance. This helps us to identify what is the response of the tumor to external beam and chemo at the time of brachy. And we use different color codes for defining the disease. The primary disease with red color, the vaginal disease with green color, the parametrial disease with blue, and if the walls are involved, then we use different colors. And this, by coloring, using various colors, we are able to differentiate the various parts of the primary tumor. And if you are able to do that successfully at diagnosis and at the time of brachy, then you know which part of the tumor has responded well to the radiation and chemo. The last important feature is you have to stage the disease according to FIGO. We also recommend TNM staging because earlier FIGO staging did not involve lymph node metastasis, but now FIGO 2018 shows the lymph node metastasis, but still it is better to document TNM because if the patient has stage 3C1, which means pelvic nodes positivity, we do not know what is the extent of primary disease. So that information you can get if you document TNM. And at the time of brachytherapy, depending on the response, we can classify them into 1, 2, 3, and 4 category, which is not required for you at this level. Once the staging is done, clinical drawings are done, these patients should mandatory go to a tumor board or a joint clinic. And in the joint clinic, the treatment decision should be taken. And the joint clinic should have minimum gyne oncologist, radiation oncologist, medical oncologist, radiologist, pathologist. And based on all these experts and the patient evaluation findings, as well as the staging, then you should decide what is the best treatment for that particular patient. What is important is you have to decide what is the best in your situation wherever you are practicing. Number depends on the expertise available, depends on what is the workload in your department, depends on what are the facilities available. And based on this, appropriate decision should be taken to every patient, and taking the patient choice into consideration as well as discussion with the patient. And this helps to evolve the treatment for every patient in terms of best outcome for cervical cancer. This is a slide which summarizes what we would do once the staging is done. On the left, you see if it is early stage, stage 1 and stage 2, we usually offer them radical surgery, especially patients who are young, who have early stage cervical cancer and where surgery alone is the curative treatment. For patients who are stage 2B to 3B and now 3C1 to 3C2 and very select group of stage 4A, not all stage 4A, but select group of patients who have stage 4A, we offer them radical cure with radiation therapy and concurrent chemotherapy. Patients who have very advanced disease or stage 4A or stage 4B and recurrent disease after initial treatment, they would go for palliative treatment. This flowchart gives in rough what you should do after a joint clinic discussion and staging is done for the particular patient, and depending on patient's condition, the treatment. What I've highlighted in the red are very important. First one is patients who are planned for radical surgery, do not practice neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery. This is invariably done in many centers. Many gynecologists do this to buy time so that the waiting list is, so that the patient comes on the table so before the waiting list is exhausted. But there is no evidence that neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery improves the outcome. In fact, it is detrimental as compared to chemoradiation. The second important point is patients who are suitable for radical radiation therapy, every patient should be evaluated for concomitant chemotherapy. And the gold standard concomitant chemotherapy regimen is cisplatin 40 milligram per meter square and should be given once weekly during the entire course of radiation therapy. So minimum of 5 to 6 cycles should be delivered during the course of radiation therapy. Patients who are not suitable for concurrent cisplatin chemotherapy, what we advise is better go for radical radiation therapy alone so that you don't compromise on the radiation therapy doses, as well as keep the overall treatment time within the limits. And this is important because many of them practice carboplatin instead of cisplatin. And carboplatin is hematologically toxic, and invariably patients land up with hematological toxicities during the external beam radiation, which compromises the overall treatment time for these patients. So you have to be very careful if medical oncologist is planning to give carboplatin. And there is no evidence that carboplatin has really significant radiosensitivity with the for cervical cancer. So coming to the principles of external beam radiation, today I'll finish conventional planning as well as virtual simulation. What is important for you to remember is, if we are planning radiation therapy, the plan is to deliver high radiotherapy doses to gross disease, whether it is primary or the nodes, including its extension into various directions, in laterally the parametrium, inferiorly the vagina, superiorly the uterus, and the gross pelvic nodes, either in external iliac or internal iliac or common iliac, or for that matter even para-aortic. The next aim, after thinking of giving higher doses to gross disease, then the next aim should be to sterilize microscopic disease. And this microscopic disease would be seen in the tissues which are adjacent to the primary tumor, as well as regional nodes which are not involved grossly on imaging or pathology. And third most important aim is while you are doing the plan to give very high doses to the primary disease and some decent doses to the microscopic disease, your aim should be to have optimal sparing of normal neighboring organs. And in cervical cancer radiotherapy, the neighboring normal organs predominantly are rectum, bladder, bowel, sigmoid, and to some extent bone marrow now. So what would you plan after deciding that this patient would require concomitant chemo radiation is shown here. This is a typical treatment prescription which you should adopt for every patient who has been planned for radical treatment with radiation therapy and concomitant chemo. So aim is to deliver radical chemo radiation with a combination of external beam and brachytherapy. For external beam radiotherapy, you have various techniques, and all these patients should undergo a simulation, and the doses are typically 45 to 50 gray at the rate of 2 gray per fraction, or 1.8 to 2 gray per fraction, 5 fractions per week, with one cycle of cisplatin 40 milligram per meter square every week for at least 5 cycles. This should be followed by a brachytherapy boost, and in India, I think a majority of the centers practice high dose rate brachytherapy, although there are centers in the world where they would do pulse dose rate as well as low dose rate still, but majority of the centers in the world now have moved to high dose rate brachytherapy. And typically the aim is to give 7 gray to point A, and I will go into the details during our brachy lectures. What is important is, at the outset, you should define that the overall treatment for every patient should be within 7 to 8 weeks. And this should be not be compromised at any cost, because every additional single day or week will compromise the outcome by significant numbers. So coming to the principles of planning, most important is counseling of the patient and preparation before you start the planning. Counseling about radiation, external beam, important is to emphasize that the treatment is combination of external and brachytherapy. There will be some side effects, and do's and don'ts have to be explained to the patient upfront. And once the patient is educated or counseled, then you need to obtain a written informed consent. And once the consent is given, then you need to give instructions to the patient regarding preparation. And the preparation essentially includes preparation of the parts, so that the perineum is clean, dietary instructions so that patient is not constipated during radiotherapy, and more important of all is psychological support if required during the course of the entire course of 7 to 8 weeks of radiation. For physicians, after patient is counseled and informed consent is taken, a pre-planning audit is very vital. It will help you to understand the every patient disease as well as the treatment. And pre-planning audit typically should be done a day or two prior to patient coming to you for planning. And pre-planning audit should include review of history, clinical findings, staging investigations, imaging findings, clinical examination findings, whether you have documented the disease at diagnosis, and then review the history for allergy to drugs, contrast, so that you are prepared, well prepared when patient comes for simulation. Review the blood tests, and if there are not recent ones, you can always ask to get a recent one, especially renal function test when you want to give IV contrast for a CT. Then you should also decide on what is the position, ideal position for this patient, what immobilization to be done. And at the end, you should decide your planning aim. Planning aim depending on whether this patient is upfront radical radio chemotherapy, or patient is for post-operative chemo radiation, or patient is for palliative treatment. And this is very important, because then depending on the intent and aim, then your technique would also be defined. Coming to the first step of the planning process, and the first step is after patient has come with the preparation as well as written informed consent. On the day of simulation, the first step is positioning and immobilization. And the aim of positioning and immobilization should be that the patient position should be comfortable. And more importantly, apart from being comfortable, patient position should be reproducible throughout the treatment. And if this is achieved, then most of your treatment quality is really good at the outset. So the first process is very vital, and you should spend some time to make sure that the patient position and immobilization is decided according to patient's comfort. And secondly, whether it is reproducible. So for cervical cancer patients, the commonly utilized position is supine, and with hands on the chest, legs straight with heels together. And I've shown this example in this picture on the right side, which is closed, of course, with the bed sheet. But what is important is if patients are supine and on the chest, if the legs are straight, if the heels are together, that's a simple measure to explain to radiotherapy technologists that once the heels are together daily, then it is more or less reproducible. But if you keep both the legs away from each other, then you don't know what distance to keep daily. So that itself will reduce the reproducibility on a daily basis. There are certain clinical situations where you decide that this patient should receive frog-leg position. And the frog-leg position principle or aim is to reduce the groin skin folds. And this is done especially when the tumors are extending into lower third vagina, or if you want to treat the inguinal lymph nodes. And this is very vital, because if there are too many groin skin folds, once you deliver radiation with multiple skin folds, there will be a lot of skin reactions, and these patients might land up with severe grade 2, grade 3 Moist desquamation and cause more delay in the completion of treatment, compromising the overall treatment time. This slide shows various immobilization devices which you can use and can be made handy and can be developed in your own departments. And the most commonest immobilization device we use is called as knee rest. And the knee rest can be made with a simple thermocol, which is shown in this picture here. And the advantage of knee rest is it reduces positioning errors for correcting the pelvic rotational movements. And also, once you put the patient in with the knee rest position, there is some flexion at the hip as well as at the knee. And once there is flexion of hip and the knees, the lumbar lordosis reduces. So if lumbar lordosis reduces, the lumbar spine is in contact with the couch. And that itself is more comfortable for patients daily while treatment and becomes more reproducible. That is why it is always good to have a knee rest with some flexion at the knee as well as the hip to stabilize the pelvis and the lumbar spine. And this becomes quite reproducible. And the lower half of the picture shows the typical knee rest which we use for frog-leg positions, so that the knees are supported when the patient is in frog-leg position. These days, a lot of vendors come to you saying that thermoplastic molds should be used for immobilization. Yes, you can use thermoplastic molds. And what is important is when you're preparing thermoplastic molds, it is very important that you use this thermoplastic mold to cover the lower rib cage to the mid thigh or upper one third of thigh. And this is important because you need to immobilize two bony parts of the body, and that is lower rib cage and the hip. And if you are not able to do that, then the abdomen, as you know, is loose and flabby. So you will not be able to get a proper immobilization with the thermoplastic mold. Secondly, if patient is obese, which is the case in most of the times these days, then this immobilization with thermoplastic mold is a bit cumbersome, because a patient can voluntarily take the abdomen inside, contract, and that itself causes a lot of issues with reproducibility. And plus, during the course of radiation, there's a weight loss and shrinkage. So that will also result in major issues. The other methods, just to complete, are body frames and body fix systems, which are used, but not routinely for cervical cancer patients. So the next step is, once you have given a commonly used immobilization device in the knee rest and in supine position, the next important step is alignment of the patient with the lasers. And this is also very vital for reproducibility of patient position daily. So to summarize, what I want to convey here is, every patient you should check what is the best position in terms of supine or prone, and preferably have some flexion at the knees, so that with the knee rest, so that the lumbar lordosis is corrected and patient is comfortable. And if required, these days you have VAC locks which can fix the body even better, but there is a learning curve how to make these VAC locks for patients so that it is reproducible daily on the machine for treatment. The next important step after patient positioning and immobilization is pelvic tumors, or pelvic radiation is a bit challenging in terms of radiation therapy, especially for external beam, because there are a lot of organs which have various filling status. And because of these, there is movement of not only the primary tumor, but also about the target. And here for pelvic radiotherapy, it is very important for you to define a bladder filling protocol as well as a rectal filling protocol. And based on this, you can reduce the uncertainties which are there in the movements of the vagina, cervix, uterus, etc. And this will be important, and when I will discuss about the newer radiation techniques next time. So you have to give some time to understand what bladder filling protocol has to be utilized in your department. For example, we use a bladder filling protocol of emptying the bladder, asking the patient to empty the bladder, take it as a zero time, and ask the patient to drink roughly around 750 ml to 1000 ml of plain water over 15 to 20 minutes. And the patient comes on the couch, whether it is CT simulation or the treatment couch, by 45 minutes from the emptying time. So within 45 minutes after bladder emptying completely, patient comes on the couch after completing drinking of let's say 750 to 1000 ml of water. For rectal filling, it is quite easy, and very important part of counseling is counsel the patient that patient has to empty the bowels daily, and preferably within few hours of your planning or treatment. And this reduces the chance that there is a lot of air filling, especially in the rectosigmoid, and that reduces the chances of repeated planning and treat and uncertainties in treatment. And this was a simple study we did in our hospital, where we evaluated a bladder filling protocol, and what we found was, after 45 minutes, the bladder, after a patient consumes 750 to 1000 ml of water after emptying, the bladder filling usually achieved is roughly around 300 to 350, and the time required is 45 minutes. And that's why I said you should get the patient on the couch 45 minutes after patient has emptied the bladder, and if you have given 750 to 1000 ml of water to drink. This is a busy slide, and this shows in summary, the treatment planning details. On the left column in blue is the conventional 2D planning. In the green is the CT simulation with virtual simulation. And the orange is the 3D conformal radiation. And on the right, dark blue is the newer radiation technology, including IMRT, VMAT, and RapidArc. So each one is important. And for you as a postgraduate student, you cannot skip any of these. So you need to know each of these, irrespective of what is your environment where you are planning your patients. So in today's lecture, I will just concentrate on conventional 2D and the virtual simulation. If you come to conventional treatment planning, and mind you, as I said, cervical cancer is common in low, middle income countries and low income countries. There are still 50% of the countries where they do not have CT in their radiotherapy departments, or in the, for that matter, even in radiology. So the simulation or the planning is still conventional. So the conventional planning principles are nothing but a fluoroscopy guided environment. And with conventional treatment planning, we usually plan a two field or a four field box technique with or without shields. And I will show you how to go about it for every process. So before you plan for conventional planning, what you need to know is what are we treating when we plan a standard conventional planning. So in a standard whole pelvis external beam radiation therapy, what we intend to do is to treat the pelvic organs, that is whole uterus, the cervix, the primary tumor, the tubo-ovarian complex, and upper third of vagina. If the vagina is not involved by primary tumor, if the vagina is involved by primary tumor, then we usually give 2 to 3 centimeters margin to the gross disease seen in the vagina. And that needs to be treated as a part of standard whole pelvis external beam radiation therapy. Laterally, the attachments, that is parametral tissue, which includes cardinal, uterosacral, and pubocervical ligaments. And the second important part of the target is the draining lymph nodes. And these draining lymph nodes would also include gross disease, as well as the lymph nodes which are at risk to harbor microscopic disease, which are not picked up on imaging. And the last important component is minor adaptations. Minor adaptations in terms of, if you want to include common iliac or parotid lymph node regions, or inferiorly, if the vaginal disease if the patient has significant vaginal disease, make sure at least 2 centimeters or 3 centimeters of uninvolved vagina and or inguinal lymph nodes are included in that target. Once you know what are the areas you need to cover in the radiation fields, then it becomes very easy when you do fluoroscopy based conventional planning. To identify some parts of small bowel, what is important is we used to give oral barium sulfate dilute solution 100 to 200 ml 15 minutes before the patient comes into the simulation, so that this looks throws a radio opaque you can see it as a radio opaque material in the fluoroscopy imaging. As I said earlier, bladder filling protocol is very important. To identify the vagina and the tip of the tumor, you invariably use a radio opaque obturator with a marker inserted into the vagina, which extends up to the ectocervix. To identify the rectum and the sigmoid, either you could push dilute barium or you could push a rectal tube. And as mentioned earlier, the first step is supine with knee rest. Then once the laser alignment is done, patient's position is fixed. Then fluoroscopic imaging is done to set an isocenter at the tip of the obturator. The obturator, which is sitting against the ectocervix, with that as the tip, the isocenter is fixed at the obturator, both on anterior and lateral view. And with the help of these anterior and lateral views, either APPA technique, that is two field technique, or a box field technique to include anteroposterior and bilateral technique, that is commonly called as box field technique, is simulated. And this is an example of anteroposterior two field technique. And for this, the borders are as follows. The superior border is usually at L4, L5 junction, so that the pelvic nodes, especially the lower common iliacs, which is usually at the level of SI joint here, is included with some margins. And if you want to include the common iliac as well as the upper common iliac as well as the lower pararoid region, then these have to, the upper border has to go even more higher. The inferior border is usually at the lower border of obturator foramen here, or at the lower border of the bony obturator, the inferior obturator part of the bone. And this is extended more if the vaginal disease is more, so that 2 centimeters of uninvolved vagina is included in the inferior border. And that can be identified by either putting a marker or measuring the length of the obturator. Unfortunately, I don't see the radiopaque obturator in this picture, but I will try and find out if I can show it in next picture. And on the lateral borders, what you have to identify is the bony true pelvis. So this is bony true pelvis on both the sides. To this, if you give 1.5 to 2 centimeters margin, and that would include adequately the obturator internus, obturator nodes or the extra iliac nodes. And in addition to these two fields, anteroposterior, in the box technique, we also include the bilateral portals. And the bilateral portals are right lateral and left lateral. And for this, the borders are as shown in this picture. The anterior border is usually a vertical line anterior to the pubic symphysis. You can appreciate the pubic symphysis in this region. Posterior border is usually a tangent which is dropped at the junction of S2 and S3. And superior and inferior border remains the same as what you have defined in the APPA technique. So this borders will help. You can see there is a obturator here. You can see a marker somewhere here. And this is the region where the uterus would lie. And this is the part of the cervix. Roughly around anterior one half to anterior two thirds of the rectum is also included. And you can see in this example, a rectal dye, which has been pushed to identify where the rectum is. And the reason why we take a vertical line between S2, S3 is that this adequately covers the presacral nodes as well as the uterosacral ligaments, which usually come and get attached in this region, so that they also get a decent dose. The next step is, if you have conventional machines where you don't have MLCs or blocks, these are the open box and rectangle fields which can be treated. But if you have an option to utilize blocks, then you could do blocks with corner shields, which is shown in this picture. The corner shields help in the upper portion to reduce the doses to the small bowel region in this region. And you can see in both AP and lateral. And the inferior corner shields will help you to reduce the dose to the inguinal folds, and thereby reducing the chances of patient getting moist desquamation in the groins. If you want to extend the field, then where you want to include the parotid nodes, then the superior border is usually kept at D12 to L1 interspace to include the renal hilar nodes, because the majority of the patients from common iliac drain into lower parotid up to renal hilar parotid nodes. And if you want to go beyond renal hilum, then you have to go higher up to include the retrocrural nodes, where you then keep the upper border at the level of D10 to L1. The lateral border is very important, which I will show you in one or two slides more. If you want to do it by fluoroscopy, it is very important that you identify the kidneys. So the best way to identify kidneys is do an IVP X-ray, and you could make out the kidneys on both the sides. The second option is the transverse processes are well seen for the lumbar vertebrae. So if you are including the transverse processes, and that width is usually around 8 to 10 centimeters at the level of hilum, then you are invariably good to cover all the parotid nodes in this region. The second, the last part of conventional simulation is virtual simulation. It is called virtual simulation because you do a CT for these patients, but you would not go into the details of 3D conformal radiation therapy processes, which I will go in detail next time. And here what you do is, with the CT simulation, you identify or you create a digitally reconstructed images, radiographs, and then you repeat the same exercise as what you did for conventional planning. And advantage of virtual simulation is it is quick and it is quite useful for centers where you have a lot of patients to treat and you don't have time to really go into various processes which are required for 3D conformal radiation. And important difference between virtual simulation and CT simulation or 3D conformal is here you need not give an IV contrast. So this becomes a useful and quite handy for patients who have renal disease and where contrast is contraindicated. So the process, in short, you place radiopy markers, fiducials in the pelvic region, one in the anterior midline and two on the lateral in the region of, let's say, the greater trochanters, and that you can see on the CT slice here, that all the three markers are in one plane. And with these markers in place, then you perform a CT with 3 to 5 millimeters of region of interest. And the images are transferred to a virtual simulation workstation. On the virtual simulation workstation, if you think that you want to define certain anatomical structures, like for example, vessels are shown in this picture here, then that vessels help you to identify or plan the conventional portals. And this is an example to show that this patient planning has been done to include the lower parotid nodal regions in the radiation portals. So the upper border is more or less up to L2, L3. And lower border you can see here at the level of obturator foramen. And in lateral DRR, you can see that the pubic anterior to pubic symphysis, the vessels are delineated. So these vessels define the external iliac nodes. And with the help of these vessels, margin is given to make sure the external iliac nodes are included in the field, in the radiation fields. So with the same concept of the borders for conventional 2D planning, as well as a box technique, you identify the anatomy and put in the fields for virtual simulation. Once you are finalized that, then the last important step, which is additional in virtual simulation, is that plan implementation, where if you go back, you have put fiducial markers. These fiducial markers will have some coordinates, and these are saved on CT, and your new coordinates will be in relation to the isocenter, AP field center, as well as the lateral field center. So with the help of these two coordinates, you can define what is the difference between what were the origins. Let's say this is marked as 000. And then in relation to this, you come to know where the coordinates are for the anterior and post and the lateral isocenter positions. With the help of these coordinates, then you make appropriate movements so that the reference points are automatically generated, and those automatically generated reference points can be moved on the CT scan without shifting the patient from the couch. And this virtual simulation workflow roughly takes around 15 to 20 minutes, not more than that. So patient lies on the couch, you give a position, knee rest is given, alignment with laser is done. Once you put the fiducial markers, then you define on the CT that these are the 000 coordinates, and do a CT and mark the borders in AP and lateral and generate the isocenter coordinates. Once you generate the isocenter coordinates, then there is a patch which is given in virtual simulation where you can define these coordinates, and these coordinates are pushed on the CT, and automatically the patient CT couch is moved to these coordinates to come to the isocenter coordinates. And then you could mark them as isocenter coordinates or make a permanent tattoo so that the treatment is delivered to those particular fields which have been planned. And this is how it would look on conventional portals on the left. And this is more on a open field. And these are on the right side are conformal with some blocks, especially with MLC. If you have a conventional LA with some MLCs without IMRT, then you could do conformal based treatment. Similar process you have to do for external field, extended field radiation. And in CT simulation, you have an advantage of contouring the kidneys on both the sides. Once you contract the kidneys on both the sides, what you have to just do is draw the portals to include the renal hilum on both the sides. And once you include them in the radiation portals, that is sufficient enough to treat or include the parotid nodal regions for external beam radiation. The pelvic component of the extended field would remain the same as what you have done earlier. And if you have MLCs, then you could shape the fields. Or if you don't have MLCs, then you'll have to make blocks, which can be used for cobalt or a conventional LINAC. The last two slides, which energy you should use for conventional techniques. On the left, I have shown a 6 mega voltage photon beam APPA technique. On the right is the 15 MV. And you can see, obviously, 15 MV is better in terms of one, your coverage, which is not compromised, let's say, in the lateral pelvic wall, whereas here in 6 MV, there's a constriction like an hourglass. Second is, you can see anteriorly and posteriorly, the skin and subcutaneous sparing is better in 15 MV as compared to 6 MV. This is even better than cobalt machine if you put another axial slice with cobalt. And this is very important because if you are doing an APPA technique, it is better to take a higher energy in the range of 10 to 15 MV. Whereas if you're doing, if the patient thickness is more, then it is preferable to do a APPA and a bilateral technique so that the subcutaneous tissue anteriorly and posteriorly gets lesser dose. In other words, you're distributing the radiation doses in various areas by reducing the higher doses. And that itself will reduce the toxicities. And this is an example which shows on the left, a 2D field technique, on the right, a standard box field technique. And what is obviously seen here in this picture is that the anterior, one third of the anterior abdominal wall, which includes the skin, subcutaneous tissue, as well as the muscle, gets very, very less dose when you do a box field technique. And same is true on the posterior one third of the anatomy. By doing this, you're going to reduce the toxicities. And if you want to know what happens even to the neighboring organs, that is rectum and bladder, is shown in the publication from this Vandibunt, where the high doses are reduced when you shift from a conventional APPA technique to a conventional box field technique. And these high doses can be reduced not only in bowel, but also to bladder as well as rectum. So the advantage of box field over conventional two field technique is that one, it helps in skin and subcutaneous sparing. Second, it reduces the high doses to these rectum, bladder, in conventional conformal techniques. And please keep this in mind because I'm going to show similar slides when I show you IMRT plans next week. So that comes to end of lecture number one, which was mainly based on conventional treatment planning. So do we have any queries which we can discuss now?
All those who have queries can unmute themselves and ask questions to sir.
There are 5 chats already. So the first chat is that is inguinal lymph node metastasis stage 3 C1 or stage 4? It's a very good question. If the vagina is not involved in lower third, and if there are extensive pelvic nodes, which includes internal iliac, external iliac, common iliac, and paraaortic, then if patient has inguinal lymph node metastasis, these patients should be deemed as stage 4B rather than stage 3C1. Whereas if the patient has significant lower third vaginal disease, and by virtue of which patient has inguinal lymph node metastasis, because the lymph node drainage from lower third of vagina is into the regional lymph nodes, that is inguinal. So in such situations, we tend to say that these are all regional lymph node metastasis. The second question was bladder protocol. Can you please tell about it? Okay. So the bladder protocol is that once the patient is has reported to you for, let's say, planning or treatment, the first thing you should do is ask the patient to empty the bladder voluntarily. Once the patient empties the bladder, ask patient to take 1 liter of water and consume it over next 15 to 20 minutes. And if you set that the empty, once she has come back after emptying the bladder, you set the time as zero and then ask her to drink water over next 15 to 20 minutes, for that matter, even half an hour. So from the time she has emptied the bladder, you take the patient on the couch, either on CT simulation or on the treatment machine by 45 minutes. And this will ensure some bladder filling, which is roughly around 300 ml, according to the study which we did in Tata Memorial Hospital. So same thing has been used for most of the gynae patients now, where on a daily basis, this patient will come, report to the RTT. Once the patient reports to RTT, RTT would instruct the patient to empty the bladder and come back. Once the patient comes back, time is noted as zero. From there, 45 minutes, patient comes for their treatment on the couch. And that is done daily on daily basis till the treatment is over. The other chats are... Posterior border in lateral field includes whole sacrum or kept at junction of S2, S3? Again, a very good question. If patient has early stage disease, let's say up to stage 2B or 3B, but not too bulky parametal disease, then S2, S3 is good enough. If the patient has 3Bs and bulky parametrium, which are involved up to lateral pelvic wall or fixed up to lateral pelvic wall, then it's a bit dangerous to cut between S2, S3. In such situations, we tend to include the whole sacrum, that is the coccyx, because the gross disease is at the edge of the external beam radiation in such techniques. And for such patients, if you are able to do CT planning or virtual simulation, then it will be very easy to see where exactly you are cutting through the S2, S3 or the whole sacrum. So there is no age criteria to avoid chemotherapy. What we tend to do is that if patient is very old, has comorbidities, we try to avoid chemotherapy. But if patient is old and has no comorbidities, but general condition is good, patient can be given chemotherapy. There is a question on something about midline blocks. Yes, midline blocks, according to me, is now historical. We used to use a lot of midline blocks, even not only at Tata Hospital, but a lot of centers across the world. But with newer linear accelerators and machines, the midline block is more or less obsolete now, barring few centers in Japan and some North Southeast Asia. And the reason why it has become obsolete is that the dosimetry is very, very complicated. And the assumption by using a physical midline block or a universal midline block is that all the patients, uterus and cervix, are in the midline or they are in the blocked area. Of course, the intention of doing a midline block is to shield the rectum and bladder in APPA portals. But what it also does is it also shields a lot of disease. And the aim of external beam radiation, as I told earlier, was to give a decent dose of external beam radiation to achieve a shrinkage in the primary tumor and make it feasible for giving high doses of brachytherapy. And I will show you a couple of slides next time when I'm showing the 3D conformal, why it is important that external beam radiation is initial external beam radiation is important for primary tumor. Next question is, why is that when in doubt, we treat assuming the lower stage? Okay, according to the rule of FIGO, if there is a discrepancy in staging, let's say three people have staged the disease, two have staged 3B and one has staged 2B, the FIGO says that you always understage and report it as 2B, because in such let's say dilemma in staging, the chance of cure should be given to the patient as high as possible, number one, so that the more radical doses or the planning is done more in favor of a lower stage so that the patient's outcome is better, not only in terms of local control, but also in terms of toxicities. And second is these patients who have discrepancy in staging between high stage and low stage, if you see the outcome is invariably better in favor of, let's say, a lower stage. So because of these two reasons, it is always good to lower the stage of the patient and report that and treat them accordingly so that the chance of cure is given to them. Do you use concurrent chemo with parietic lymph nodes also? Is it too toxic? Yeah, that's also a good question. If patient is suitable for concomitant chemo, irrespective of whether it is box field, conventional APPA technique or extended field radiation, you should always try and give concomitant cisplatin chemotherapy. What you should not do, especially when patients are undergoing extended field radiation, is ask your medical oncology colleague not to give carboplatin if patient is not suitable for cisplatin, because if you do extended field radiation for these patients, the marrow which is radiated in a patient who has extended field is will account to almost 75%. And when marrow is radiated in extended field to up to 75% of the marrow, carboplatin is hematologic toxic. So these patients invariably land up with a very, very low count, and a low count resulting in neutropenia, then febrile neutropenia, and then this compromises the outcome. So you have to be very careful when you're giving extended field radiation and a medical oncologist say that cisplatin cannot be given. In such situations, better to go for radiation alone rather than giving carboplatin.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Admin, can you mute? Somebody's talking. Yeah. So the next question is, sir, what is your feedback of planning two opposing? What is your feedback of planning two opposing for initial few days of RT and then to switch off to the four field or conformal so that the time delay of treatment can be shortened? I don't think there is any delay in planning between box field and two field techniques. So I don't see any reason why you should start with APP and then shift on to box field. If you are, as I said, if you are giving box field, the advantages are that you spare skin subcutaneous tissue doses as well as the high doses to rectum, bladder, and to some extent sigmoid. So that itself will be advantages for better compliance to treatment for patients who are planned for radical chemo radiation. Next question is, can you please tell about the inguinal lymph node borders? I will cover that in the 3D conformal radiation planning next time. Same is true for the next question, when to give nodal boost after EBRT and boost to what dose and what is the ball constant to be considered in such case? So Rakesh, I'll do that in the next talk. Radiation to the cervix always makes the ovaries lose their function. Should we tell the patient about this? Yes, obviously. You have to tell two things about pelvic radiation, especially in younger women, that they will not be able to conceive anymore. And second, they will always land up with premature menopause. And these two are very important part of counseling, because patients should be aware about this. And third thing is that they will not be able to menstruate henceforth. And there is some social stigma associated with this. So that is why better you should inform them that all these three effects set in once the radiation is over, over a period of time. Otherwise, they get psychologically affected later on when they come to know that because of our treatment, they do not have menstruation, or they cannot conceive, or they feel insecure because husband or the partner would say that I cannot have sexual, let's say, interaction because of lack of menstruation and lack of function. Next question is, if nodal boost, I will cover nodal boost next time. Next question is, if lower third vagina and inguinal lymph nodes positive, then what stage? Yeah, it is still loco-regional treatment, loco-regional staging. I would go by TNM staging, where you can see that in TNM staging, I think N2 is what is defined for lymph node, but I can check. I'm not sure whether we can really give some stage to these patients. There's a question, how to shield iliac crest on 2D. Okay, so iliac crest, the question is, why would you shield iliac crest in 2D? Iliac crest invariably have active bone marrow. So a lot of people think about shielding the iliac crest, but it is very dangerous to do that on 2D planning. But I will show you something about bone marrow next time when I'm showing the contouring. The next question is, thank you, sir. Old age till what age, sir? The old age criteria is very loose. We take in India 65 years, but in the West, it may go up to 70 years also. Do you have a cap for maximum dose of weekly cisplatin? Well, in our protocol, we put a cap of 65 milligram per meter square, 65 milligram total dose, because if you go higher than that, it will be like 3 weekly chemo, that is 100 milligrams. So that would be a bit more toxic. But there's no rule of thumb that the capping has to be done. But in Indian setting and most of the low middle income countries, I think 65 milligram is good enough as a radiosensitizer. Next question is, which stage onwards PET CT should be done? As my lectures were related to planning, I didn't go into details of various imaging modalities, but just to answer in short, according to international guidelines now, ESGO, ESTRO, and ESMO, we are suggesting a PET CT whole body for all the patients who have stage more than 1B1. And this is important to identify the pelvic as well as paraaortic metastasis so that the treatment can be tailored. Next question is, in paraaortic irradiation, why is it necessary to cover bilateral renal hilum? Is it enough if we cover only the left renal hilum? Yes, of course, the renal hilums were included on both the sides because the paraaortic lymph nodal chain, if you go into the details of the location of paraaortic nodes at the level of renal hilum, on the right side, you have IVC, on the left side, you have aorta, and on the left hilum, on the left kidney, the left renal artery is having certain paraaortic lymph nodes. So that is why we go up to left renal hilum. On the right is very closer to the transverse process. And if you see, the paraaortic or para cable nodes are quite close to the renal hilum. And these were defined as anatomical landmarks and conventional planning so that you don't land up with geographical miss. Whereas nowadays, if you do a CT planning, you can always give certain margin to these vessels, great vessels, that is vena cava as well as the aorta. And there are some guidelines which are coming up where certain values have been given in terms of margins to these vessels, where you can include these efficiently, ignoring what is where the renal hilum is. Thank you, Your Excellence. Can you please tell extended field is preferred over extended field RT is preferred or sequential radiation is preferred when paraaortic nodes are involved? So when you have patient of 3C2, which means paraaortic lymph nodes are positive, we would not recommend sequential radiation, rather extended field radiation from day one, so that the gross disease, whether it is primary tumor or the nodes, are covered efficiently from day one of external beam radiation. So we would never do a sequential for pelvic followed by paraaortic. Bladder invasion, how to treat palliative versus radical? I showed in my slide that only few patients who have stage 4A by virtue of bladder wall invasion, bladder mucosa invasion or rectal invasion are treated with radical intent. These are the patients who have focal involvement. And these are very, very early invasion. So such patients who have good general condition, whom you can think can tolerate treatment, should go for radical treatment, whereas patients who have extensive disease in the bladder, which includes a tumor eroding the half of the bladder or half of the rectum, and there's a gross hematuria or gross bleeding per rectum, and patient has a frozen pelvis and general condition is poor, such patients would go for palliative treatments. Best way to stage cancer cervix. The best way is, if you are looking at clinical radiological, local staging is best way done by clinical examination, if required examination under anesthesia, followed by an additional imaging. For that, I would say that a PET CT, depending on the stage. If you want to make it resource constrained or resource stratified, then for early stage, I would just rely more on CT abdomen pelvis to pick up gross nodes and classify them as stage 3C. Then there was a question on role of ovarian transposition in young females before starting RT. Yes, it's a good question. Be careful. Ovarian transposition should be attempted only in specific conditions. Condition number one is young who have preserved ovarian functions. Second, patient should not have adenocarcinoma or adenosquamous histology. Third, relatively early stage. Early stage means, let's say, stage 2B and not 3B. And in such situations, laparoscopic ovarian transposition can be done by a gyne-oncologist. And what is important is to educate the gyne-oncologist as to where these ovaries should be transposed. The ideal situation is they should be transposed in paracolic gutters higher above the pelvis, true pelvis, so that, you know, even radiation, scattered radiation should not reach these ovaries transposed. And the limitation for surgeon for ovarian transposition is that they cannot sacrifice the ovarian artery. So the longer the ovarian artery patient has, the better is for the surgeon to mobilize the ovaries higher up in the abdomen. But if the ovarian artery pedicles are smaller, then it is very difficult to really achieve some sparing even after ovarian transposition. But if you want to offer ovarian transposition, my recommendation is that you should always get the hormonal levels done before the transposition is done. Hormonal levels repeated before you start the radiation. And then after radiation is completed, every 3 to 6 months, get the hormonal test done to make sure that there is some amount of function preservation. Can you please repeat the rationale behind corner shielding once more? So the corner shieldings in APP and lateral field, the upper corners in the AP field help us to reduce the high doses to the small bowel, both in anterior-posterior field as well as the lateral field. And in the lateral field, anterior shield is more mainly important. The lower shields, the lower part of the portals where the shielding is done, reduces the high dose region to the inguinal folds. By doing that, the grade 2, grade 3 skin moist desquamation toxicities or reactions would be less. So with the shielding, you are achieving these two advantages. Implications of new staging system on treatment decisions. It has not yet impacted any treatment decision so far, because you have to treat most of the patients with radical intent between stage 2B to stage 3C2. And for stage 4A, 4B still remains the same, what I've discussed earlier. Next question is, what will be the EBRT doses if patient has received hemostatic single RT and a gap between hemostatic and RT? There are no fixed rules for adjusting the doses after hemostatic RT. The best way to do it is, if you give a 6th grade or 8th grade today, wait for at least 3 to 4 weeks so that the acute reaction settle down of this high dose, and then you can start conventional radiation. The best way to do that is, when you start the conventional radiation after hemostatic, ignore the earlier doses and see how patient response to the conventional radiation during the entire course of radiation. Typically, I would evaluate this patient at fourth week to see the response. And at fourth week, if the response is good and you can do a brachytherapy application to cover the disease with adequate doses, go ahead and do brachy more and compromise on external beam radiation. Whereas if you feel that the response to external radiation at fourth week is still not good enough, then ignore 6 to 8 gray and complete 45 to 50 gray and then take her for brachytherapy subsequently. Energy and fields in extended pelvic radiation. Yes, higher the energy, better, because in extended field radiation, if you see right from abdomen down to pelvis, the anteroposterior suppression is variable. And typically, most of these women will have, if they have flat or scaphoid abdomen, then it is not a problem because a single energy, either 6 MV or 10 MV, will uniformly give good, decent doses. Whereas if patient is slightly obese, so obese means the upper part of abdomen is thicker as compared to the lower part. So in such situations, you have to be very careful in choosing the energy and make sure you don't compromise on paraotic nodal coverage by 95% isodose. And the reason why I say that is because for pelvic nodes and paraotic nodes, external beam radiation doses are 100% of the treatment. Whereas for the primary tumor, the 100% the external beam radiation is only comprising of 50% of the dose. The remaining 50% dose comes from brachytherapy. Next, best imaging modality for paraotic delineation for extended field. CT abdomen pelvis with IV contrast is good enough imaging modality. Of course, many of them also do PET CT and do try to fuse, but a word of caution, fusion leads to confusion. So if you have a PET CT and if you have flat couch for radiotherapy planning and the lasers, then best would be PET CT in treatment position acquisition and then do contouring on PET CT. When there's a discrepancy between MRI and clinical findings on the extent of vaginal involvement, how to decide on inguinal nodal radiation? Question is very good, but the vaginal disease is best examined by clinical examination. And I say that because vaginal mucosal disease cannot be identified that easily on MRI. And MRI is a challenge if you are not done with a good protocol. So invariably, if you want to see the paravaginal disease, then the MRI imaging is better than the clinical examination. But for mucosal disease in the vagina, clinical examination is more thorough and better as compared to MRI. So I would decide more on clinical examination for including the inguinal nodals when vaginal disease is extending into lower part. Last question is portals for extended field RT. So which was mentioned in my talk, and I will show this again next week when I'm doing 3D conformance, so you can check that. In which cases we can give palliative RT 10 gray once monthly followed by brachy, what should be the brachy dose? So these are all patients where you have decided that you should give palliative radiation. So these are patients who have frozen pelvis, who have stage 3B advanced disease or stage 4A, and you give 10 gray once monthly. So if you have given 10 gray today, patient is usually called after 1 month for next fraction evaluation. And once you give the second treatment, that is another 10 gray, then patient goes back home and comes back after 1 more month. And if patient has responded really well, then we plan for third treatment. And after third treatment, patient is planned for brachy. Now, the reason why I say this is very vital is if you are able to successfully give 10 gray once monthly for 3 doses, that is 30 gray in 3 fractions over 60 days, this fractionation schedule, if you calculate EQD2, is in the range of 40 to 245 gray. So if you are able to give that and add to that brachytherapy, to make it a total dose of 75 to 80 gray EQD2. And if you give 10 patients this schedule, out of 10, 5 or 6 would come for the second fraction, 3 or 4 would come for the third fraction, and 1 or 2 only would come for Brachy. So please be careful that out of 10, only 2, that means 20% of patients will come for such treatments. And you have to explain them that in such situation, when patient comes for brachytherapy, the late effects in these patients are going to be invariably higher. Re-radiation indications, dose, technique, duration, that's another lecture itself. Let me compile it next lecture sometime. In case of radical radiotherapy, if long gap between external beam and brachy, as example, 3 months, then is it justified to give brachy? So my take on this is, for cervical cancer brachy, for cervical cancer treatment, external beam constitutes 50% of the dose. Brachytherapy constitutes another 50% of the dose. So if patient has received external beam only to the primary tumor and has come after 3 months, it means this patient has received only 50% of the radiation doses. Depending on the disease status at 3 months, I would plan for brachytherapy. And if patient has a response wherein brachytherapy can be done and brachytherapy covers the gross disease with adequate doses, I would go ahead and do brachytherapy even after 3 months. Criteria to say parotid lymph node is significant in CCT. Yes, that's a standard criteria. Size, shape, and loss of fatty hilum. Size more than 1 centimeters. Shape, if it is not oblong, oval, and if it is more rounded, and loss of fatty hilum. These are the features which are classically taught by radiologists that these would be clinically significant. And when a CT report says indeterminate PR nodes, then it is your clinical decision. And I'll show an example in the next presentation where you have to decide which patients should undergo paraaortic lymph node radiation in such situations. Next question is, can brachytherapy be started along with external beam or after 50 gray? That I will cover in next topic, next lecture. Please take a class on uncommon histologies. Uncommon histologies are not common, so don't worry about uncommon histologies. I will try and cover in a couple of slides in subsequent talks. Okay. I think the questions are done. Who is coordinating? I don't know the name.
Thank you so much for the excellent presentation, sir.
What's your name? Sorry. Is it Ankita? Hello. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. See you sometime. I think next Saturday may be possible, but later. But I will let you know. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.